Go?
Yeah, we're good.
Okay, sorry, I didn't know that. All right.
Oh yeah, no worries.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه بسم الله والحمد لله وكفى وسلامه على عبده الذي اصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه المقتدي الفضلاء السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I send my peace and my blessings upon each and every single one of you, and I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has showered each of you abundantly with his mercy and with his pardon, inshallah. The second day of fasting and second day of breaking our fast, may it lead to nothing but taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and appreciation for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. So alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, we completed the overarching meanings and principles of the first juz' of the Qur'an, which is Surah Al-Fatiha and the opening of Surah Al-Baqarah. And one of the points that we left out on is how to maintain an understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the generations. And one of the things that we went over was we paid attention to something that Surah Al-Baqarah really shows us on how to correct our understandings from previous nations. And among the things that Surah Al-Baqarah corrects, or it gives us another interpretation of certain events that many religions believe in, like the story of Adam, right? Like the story of Iblis, was he a fallen angel or was he not? Why did Adam and Eve have to go what they went through? The stories of Moses and the people who followed him with Bani Israel and so on and so forth. So in that beginning, or in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, it's really giving us a fresher perspective. It's giving us a fresher perspective on how to truly submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how to also remove ourselves from some of the tricks or some of the delusions that we put ourselves through. Remember last night we discussed that in Surah Al-Baqarah at the very beginning, one of the major things that ended up happening was that people then started creating idols for themselves to replace Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when they were questioned about their reasoning, when they were questioned about their own faith, they met that questioning, or they met that that questioning with mockery and jest and arrogance. And they wouldn't submit to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reveal to them through Sayyidina Musa. So one of the ways to correct this is to establish relationships and to impart wisdom and advice to generations that come after us, meaning our children. That we give them the blessings of the message of Islam. We give them the blessings of hearing the words of the prophets sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa sallallahu alaihi ajma'in, that we give them these blessings and we give them these meanings. Now, one of the main things that we start to get into in the second part of Surah Al-Baqarah is really we start going over transitional meanings, right? For instance, what do I mean by transitional meanings? It is in this part of the surah where we actually experience certain things being redefined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, in the first half, certain things were defined for Bani Israel and for the people around Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And now things are being redefined for the people around Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam and the followers of Muhammad. So right now we're getting into the game changerness, right? If you want to call it that. There's a little bit of a game changing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing. And one of the things that it begins to becoming highlighted is that one of the ultimate forms of misguidance, right? Or one of the outward manifestations of misguidance or not having a submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when we become obsessed or when we become nitpicky over outward details, right? Where we have an excessive preoccupation with outward forms of or images of piety. And this is exactly what happened. This is exactly what happened in with the Bani Israel after Moses, right? When Jesus comes and begins to preach to Bani Israel, it's against this type of understanding. That it is not about an image of piety, it's not about a perception of piety, it's truly about what's in the heart. And one of the things that the Muslims were tested with was the switching of the Qibla, right? Was the switching of the Qibla, where now meanings are going to be altered and meanings are going to be exchanged. And will we be people who submit to it as it comes? Or will we be people who question who retort and who go against and challenge what is being revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, the true servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when worshipping Him and receives a command, they don't deem how it is to be, but they follow through with how Allah deemed it to be. Meaning that they don't look to hear a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't look to hear a command of God Almighty and say, this is how I would want it to be. Or meaning you're not projecting your own interpretation of it. You're accepting things as they are being mentioned. You're accepting things as they are being mentioned. And it even uses a metaphor in this part of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about people who you get into argumentation with. Like if you try to facilitate the interpretation of religion to meet other people's whims and their own desires, that no matter how much you bend over backwards, they'll never accept it. They'll never accept it. Right? And he even gives the example that says, even if you were to bring them all the proofs, they will never accept your way. Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of God. And this comes to some of the verses that we see in the surah, that certain people will not accept you unless you follow their way. Meaning, as a Muslim, we will never, or we may never be accepted truthfully until we abandon the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until we reject. So it's really now we begin to understand. Now we begin to truly open ourselves up in this chapter of the Quran to the, I guess you'd say, not paying so much attention, although there is an important amount of detail that needs to be paid or that needs to be understood when it comes to the outward commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the outward manifestations of what following God's commands are. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to get us to pay attention to what is underneath the surface. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to get us to become more principled in our following of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to get us more ingrained rather than just, for instance, to give an image. There's a national scholar, mashallah. He tells a story oftentimes of how he converted to Islam and how many people around him, when he first converted to Islam, they didn't believe him, right? They didn't believe that he had become Muslim. He's like, no, I swear to God, guys, I'm Muslim. And like, man, get out of here. You're not a Muslim. And he's like, oh yeah? Let me prove it to you. He pulled out two things, a kufi and a miswak, you know, like the wooden brush. He's like, aha, I'm Muslim. And they're like, oh, dang, you're a Muslim. You became Muslim, huh? You got a kufi and you have a siwak, right? You have that brush. That must mean you're Muslim. So what we're trying to get out of in this part of the chapter is removal from the idea that a big beard is what makes a pious Muslim man. That a hijab is the only thing that makes up a pious Muslim woman, right? That these things, although they are important because the Prophet told us they were, and because the Quran commands us to, they are important, they have their significance, but it is not everything. It is not everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to get us to pay attention, to the underlying themes and the underlying principles. Habib. So sorry, my son is upset, but alhamdulillah, he's good. So following the underlying themes and the underlying principles of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to show us. One of the other beautiful verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drops before us is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines what piety actually is, right? What the piety actually is. And he says that piety isn't that you face your face, you face to the east or you face to the west, or that you orient yourself in any particular image or in any particular way, but piety is by action, right? Piety is not a look. Piety isn't an aesthetic, right? Piety is not something that's pleasing to the eye. Piety can be quite difficult. Piety may not look pretty. But piety, ultimately in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is judged by one criteria and one criteria alone: action. What is our action? What is our commitment to doing good? Or how is our commitment to doing good? Is it wavery? Do we only do the good, or do we only commit ourselves to the good when the times are easy? Or do we commit to the principles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes even when times are difficult? Do we pray only when everyone around us is praying, or do we pray just as much in public as we do in private? Do we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or do we behave in the same way that we do publicly as we do privately? So again, we come down to these conflicting images of piety that were presented in the earlier part and then in the latter part, where piety is not an image, it's not just a perception, it's a way of life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines it not only by prayer, He defines it by giving up your wealth for the good cause. He defines it by establishing your relations with your kin. He also talks about it, you know, meaning that generosity isn't something that you only give when times are good, but again, you're doing it in difficult times as well. So this is very important in what the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what God Almighty is saying. And we ought to really reflect on these parts where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also defines for us taqwa. And on a note, we said that the first juz' of the Qur'an establishes a principle. It establishes a very foundational principle that there are many things that we do not know of, right? That are unknown, they are metaphysical, that we will never truly understand. And it gets emphasized in this part of the Qur'an. It gets emphasized in this part of the Qur'an when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about martyrs. The people who die in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the people who die selflessly, right? Selflessly, while they try to defend the rights of others, or while they try to uphold, right? They try to uphold the rights of others and they lost their lives in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says that they are not dead. That they are not dead. He says, indeed they are living. And indeed, you may not perceive it, but know that it is true, that they are with their Lord getting His provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We may not understand it, we may not be able to perceive it, we may not even be able to wrap our minds around it, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us this is how it is. This is exactly how it is. And it's something that we were shown in the earliest chapter that we ought to accept. Right? We said faith, first of all, begins in the mind. Faith begins with reason. But then ultimately there's a point of our faith where we give in to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entirely. That's why there's an element, or there's a very big meaning about the word Islam, which is submission, not peace. Peace attained through submission. But again, we become convinced that this is the message of Allah. We become convinced that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a truthful prophet. We become convinced that this makes sense for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants of us. And then we submit. And this is the part where in Islam, faith begins to play a role of trust, that we simply trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the beautiful elements that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets into in this chapter, and we'll end on these last two notes, which is experiencing taqwa, or having taqwa in relationships. And in the relationships we're talking about, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really emphasizes is when we're looking to get married, the whole process of marriage, and if we should ever seek a divorce, that taqwa is absolutely paramount here. That taqwa is absolutely paramount in matters of seeking relationships and in matters of ever maybe, la samahallah, getting a divorce. That when it comes to our transactional relationships, right? Because it may be easier to have taqwa when it comes to it being me and Allah, right? My relationship with Allah, owing up to what Allah asks of me. But then when it goes into owing up to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks of me with other people, that might be different. And that might be much more difficult. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places a special emphasis on taqwa in the matters where the rights of others are considered. Where the rights of others are considered. And one of the beautiful stories and more meaningful stories is really the story of Saul or Talut, where it's talking about the story between David and Goliath, and how again a certain level of trust and a certain level of real taqwa meaning that you are mindful of what you are doing when it comes to triumphing or being triumphant over what seems like odds that you wouldn't really want to bet on, right? To give an example for those of us, for us old folks, when Muhammad Ali got out of prison and went up against George Foreman. George Foreman was the Goliath of the boxing world, one punch knockout power. Never fought a fight, I think, that went longer than three rounds, right? And was younger, stronger than Muhammad Ali. But Muhammad Ali, again, just was like, no, I'm going to do it. It was the David and Goliath story of boxing. And that's a little bit, that's a good lesson in of itself, having faith in yourself. But ultimately, when it comes to the real things, outside of sports, having faith and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if we are following His way, and we are following His guidance, the Quran asks us a question. How many people were in a smaller group, or were in a group where it was less likely that they win, and because of their sabr, because of their faith, because of their patience, because of their reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they ended up being victorious. So again, this part of the Quran is hinting at a transition of meaning, a transition of what we were maybe told in previous traditions or in previous revelations, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to emphasize certain things in this part of the Quran. In this part of the Quran, right? Because most revelations before the Quran were specific to groups of people. Most revelations before the Quran were specific to a particular group of people. Whereas the Quran now, the shift needs to be made because it's not addressing a group of people. It's addressing humanity for all times. Right? Humanity across the ages. And there is a shift or a transition in how things are to be understood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God Almighty, begins to lay these foundations out. So that is a quick hodgepodge, principled approach at understanding the second part of the Quran, the second juzu. And that's what we listened to last night. And alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, we're about to shift over to our dear brother Malik, where we're going to be going over the verses going into the third chapter of the Quran, which is the third surah, Surah Ali Imran, and we will also be getting into the third juz' of the Quran, which we will cover tomorrow evening. So whenever you join us, know that we are going to be going over the juz' of the Quran that was recited the night previous, right? So last night we recited the second juz' and we just went over the meanings of the second juz'. Tonight we're going to be listening to the recitation of the third juz' and we will be going over the meanings of the third juz'. But before we get to the tilawa of the Quran, we're going to be going over a dua, right? Our beloved Dr. Shabib has been preparing for us a dua of the day. And the dua of the day, if you're on YouTube or Facebook, you can see this, but if you're on Instagram, I apologize. We don't really have the technology to do that. You guys should like be beefing with Instagram and be like, hey, get us our stuff. So for those of us on Instagram, I'll recite it out loud. And inshallah, we will be going over it. This dua is known as Sayyidul Istighfar, or the master of forgiveness, or the dua of forgiveness, of ultimate forgiveness. And I'm going to read it in Arabic, and then we will do it in English, the meaning. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant khalaqtani wa ana abduk wa ana ala ahdika wa wa'dika mastata'at. أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء لك بذنبي فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت. And this is really a praiseworthy dua according to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the translation of this dua is, O Allah, you are my Lord. None has the right to be worshipped but you. You created me and I am your slave or servant. And I am faithful to my covenant and my promise as much as I can. I seek refuge with you from all the evil that I may have done. And I acknowledge before you all the blessings that you have bestowed upon me. And I confess to you all of my sins. So I entreat you to forgive my sins, for nobody can forgive sins except you, O Allah. It is in the power of no one other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's get into the Quran that we will be reciting right now. Malik, are you on Instagram, inshallah?
Yes.
Okay, let me find you and add you. And then let's test it just in case there's any feedback.
Can you say something?
Assalamu alaikum. Okay. So, inshallah, we'll be transitioning over to the recitation of the Quran. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم نزل عليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه وأنزل التوراة والإنجيل من قبل هدى للناس وأنزل الفرقان إن الذين كفروا بآيات الله لهم عذاب شديد والله عزيز ذو انتقام إن الله لا يخفى عليه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء هو الذي يصوركم في الأرحام كيف يشاء لا إله إلا هو العزيز الحكيم هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه ابتغاء الفتنة وابتغاء تأويله وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا وما يذكر إلا أولو الألباب ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا إنك جامع الناس ليوم لا ريب فيه إن الله لا يخلف الميعاد إن الذين كفروا لن تغني عنهم أموالهم ولا أولادهم من الله شيئا وأولئك هم وقود النار كدأب آل فرعون والذين من قبلهم كذبوا بآياتنا فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم والله شديد العقاب قل للذين كفروا ستغلبون وتحشرون إلى جهنم وبئس المهاد قد كان لكم آية في فئتين التقتا فئة تقاتل في سبيل الله وأخرى كافرة يرونهم مثليهم رأي العين والله يؤيد بنصره من يشاء إن في ذلك لعبرة لأولي الأبصار زين للناس حب الشهوات من النساء والبنين والقناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة والخيل المسومة والأنعام والحرث ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا والله عنده حسن المآب قل أأنبئكم بخير من ذلكم للذين اتقوا عند ربهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها وأزواج مطهرة ورضوان من الله والله بصير بالعباد الذين يقولون ربنا إننا آمنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وقنا عذاب النار الصابرين والصادقين والقانتين والمنفقين والمستغفرين بالأسحار شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا هو والملائكة وأولو العلم قائما بالقسط لا إله إلا هو العزيز الحكيم إن الدين عند الله الإسلام وما اختلف الذين أوتوا الكتاب إلا من بعد ما جاءهم العلم بغيا بينهم ومن يكفر بآيات الله فإن الله سريع الحساب فإن حاجوك فقل أسلمت وجهي لله ومن اتبعني وقل للذين أوتوا الكتاب والأميين أسلمتم فإن أسلموا فقد اهتدوا وإن تولوا فإنما عليك البلاغ والله بصير بالعباد إن الذين يكفرون بآيات الله ويقتلون النبيين بغير حق ويقتلون الذين يأمرون بالقسط من الناس فبشرهم بعذاب أليم أولئك الذين حبطت أعمالهم في الدنيا والآخرة وما لهم من ناصرين ألم تر إلى الذين أوتوا نصيبا من الكتاب يدعون إلى كتاب الله ليحكم بينهم ثم يتولى فريق منهم وهم معرضون ذلك بأنهم قالوا لن تمسنا النار إلا أياما معدودات وغرهم في دينهم ما كانوا يفترون فكيف إذا جمعناهم ليوم لا ريب فيه ووفيت كل نفس ما كسبت وهم لا يظلمون قل اللهم مالك الملك تؤتي الملك من تشاء وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير تولج الليل في النهار وتولج النهار في الليل وتخرج الحي من الميت وتخرج الميت من الحي وترزق من تشاء بغير حساب لا يتخذ المؤمنون الكافرين أولياء من دون المؤمنين ومن يفعل ذلك فليس من الله في شيء إلا أن تتقوا منهم تقاه ويحذركم الله نفسه وإلى الله المصير قل إن تخفوا ما في صدوركم أو تبدوه يعلمه الله ويعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض والله على كل شيء قدير يوم تجد كل نفس ما عملت من خير محضرا وما عملت من سوء تود لو أن بينها وبينه أمدا بعيدا ويحذركم الله نفسه والله رؤوف بالعباد قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم قل أطيعوا الله والرسول فإن تولوا فإن الله لا يحب الكافرين إن الله اصطفى آدم ونوحا وآل إبراهيم وآل عمران على العالمين ذرية بعضها من بعض والله سميع عليم إذ قالت امرأة عمران رب إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محررا فتقبل مني إنك أنت السميع العليم فلما وضعتها قالت رب إني وضعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا قال يا مريم أنى لك هذا قالت هو من عند الله إن الله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب هنالك دعا زكريا ربه قال رب هب لي من لدنك ذرية طيبة إنك سميع الدعاء فنادته الملائكة وهو قائم يصلي في المحراب أن الله يبشرك بيحيى مصدقا بكلمة من الله وسيدا وحصورا ونبيا من الصالحين قال رب أنى يكون لي غلام وقد بلغني الكبر وامرأتي عاقر قال كذلك الله يفعل ما يشاء قال رب اجعل لي آية قال آيتك ألا تكلم الناس 3 أيام إلا رمزا واذكر ربك كثيرا وسبح بالعشي والإبكار وإذ قالت الملائكة يا مريم إن الله اصطفاك وطهرك واصطفاك على نساء العالمين يا مريم اقنتي لربك واسجدي واركعي مع الراكعين ذلك من أنباء الغيب نوحيه إليك وما كنت لديهم إذ يلقون أقلامهم أيهم يكفل مريم وما كنت لديهم إذ يختصمون إذ قالت الملائكة يا مريم إن الله يبشرك بكلمة منه اسمه المسيح عيسى بن مريم وجيها عيسى بن مريم وجيها في الدنيا والآخرة ومن المقربين ويكلم الناس في المهد وكهلا ومن الصالحين قال رب أنى يكون لي ولد ولم يمسسني بشر قال كذلك الله يخلق ما يشاء إذا قضى أمرا فإنما يقول له كن فيكون ويعلمه الكتاب والحكمة والتوراة والإنجيل ورسولا إلى بني إسرائيل أني قد جئتكم بآية من ربكم أني أخلق لكم من الطين كهيئة الطير فأنفخ فيه فيكون طيرا بإذن الله وأبرئ الأكمه والأبرص وأحيي الموتى بإذن الله وأنبئكم بما تأكلون وما تدخرون في بيوتكم إن في ذلك لآية لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين ومصدقا لما بين يدي من التوراة ولأحل لكم بعض الذي حرم عليكم وجئتكم بآية من ربكم فاتقوا الله وأطيعون إن الله ربي وربكم فاعبدوه هذا صراط مستقيم فلما أحس عيسى منهم الكفر قال من أنصاري إلى الله قال الحواريون نحن أنصار الله آمنا بالله واشهد بأننا مسلمون ربنا آمنا بما أنزلت واتبعنا الرسول فاكتبنا مع الشاهدين ومكروا ومكر الله والله خير الماكرين إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي ومطهرك من الذين كفروا وجاعل الذين اتبعوك فوق الذين كفروا إلى يوم القيامة ثم إلي مرجعكم فأحكم بينكم فيما كنتم فيه تختلفون فأما الذين كفروا فأعذبهم عذابا شديدا في الدنيا والآخرة وما لهم من ناصرين وأما الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فيوفيهم أجورهم والله لا يحب الظالمين ذلك نتلوه عليك من الآيات والذكر الحكيم إن مثل عيسى عند الله كمثل آدم خلقه من تراب ثم قال له كن فيكون الحق من ربك فلا تكن من الممترين فمن حاجك فيه من بعد ما جاءك من العلم فقل تعالوا ندع أبناءنا وأبناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم وأنفسنا وأنفسكم ثم نبتهل فنجعل لعنة الله على الكاذبين إن هذا لهو القصص الحق وما من إله إلا الله وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِالْمُفْسِدِينَ قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَقُولُوا اشْهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ لِمَ تُحَاجُّونَ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمَا أُنْزِلَتِ التَّوْرَاةُ وَالْإِنْجِيلُ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ ها أنتم هؤلاء حاججتم فيما لكم به علم فلم تحاجون فيما ليس لكم به علم والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون ما كان إبراهيم يهوديا ولا نصرانيا ولكن كان حنيفا مسلما وما كان من المشركين إن أولى الناس بإبراهيم للذين اتبعوه وهذا النبي والذين آمنوا والله ولي المؤمنين ودت طائفة من أهل الكتاب لو يضلونكم وما يضلون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون يا أهل الكتاب لم تكفرون بآيات الله وأنتم تشهدون يا أهل الكتاب لم تلبسون الحق بالباطل وتكتمون الحق وأنتم تعلمون وقال الطائفة من أهل الكتاب آمنوا بالذي أنزل على الذين آمنوا وجه النهار واكفروا آخره لعلهم يرجعون ولا تؤمنوا إلا لمن تبع دينكم قل إن الهدى هدى الله أن يؤتى أحد مثل ما أوتيتم أو يحاجوكم عند ربكم قل إن الفضل بيد الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل والله واسع عليم يختص برحمته من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم ومن أهل الكتاب من إن تأمنه بقنطار يؤديه إليك ومنهم من إن تأمنه بدينار لا يؤديه إليك إلا ما دمت عليه قائما ذلك بأنهم قالوا ليس علينا في الأميين سبيل ويقولون على الله الكذب وهم يعلمون بلى من أوفى بعهده واتقى فإن الله يحب المتقين إن الذين يشترون بعهد الله وأيمانهم ثمنا قليلا أولئك لا خلاق لهم في الآخرة ولا يكلمهم الله ولا ينظر إليهم يوم القيامة ولا يزكيهم ولهم عذاب أليم وإن منهم لفريقا يلوون ألسنتهم بالكتاب لتحسبوه من الكتاب وما هو من الكتاب ويقولون هو من عند الله وما هو من عند الله ويقولون على الله الكذب وهم يعلمون ما كان لبشر أن يكلمه الله إلا ما كان لبشر أن يؤتيه الله الكتاب والحكم والنبوة ثم يقول للناس كونوا عبادا لي من دون الله ولكن كونوا ربانيين بما كنتم تعلمون الكتاب وبما كنتم تدرسون ولا يأمركم أن تتخذوا الملائكة والنبيين أربابا أيأمركم بالكفر بعد إذ أنتم مسلمون وإذ أخذ الله ميثاق النبيين لما آتيتكم من كتاب وحكمة ثم جاءكم رسول مصدق لما معكم لتؤمنن به ولتنصرنه قال أأقررتم وأخذتم على ذلكم إصري قالوا أقررنا قال فاشهدوا وأنا معكم من الشاهدين فمن تولى بعد ذلك فأولئك هم الفاسقون أفغير دين الله يبغون وله أسلم من في السماوات والأرض طوعا وكرها وإليه يرجعون قل آمنا بالله وما أنزل علينا وما أنزل على إبراهيم وإسماعيل وإسحاق ويعقوب والأسباط وما أوتي موسى وعيسى والنبيون من ربهم لا نفرق بين أحد منهم ونحن له مسلمون ومن يبتغ غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه وهو في الآخرة من الخاسرين كيف يهدي الله قوما كفروا بعد إيمانهم وشهدوا أن الرسول حق وجاءهم البينات والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين أولئك جزاؤهم أن عليهم لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين خالدين فيها لا يخفف عنهم العذاب ولا هم ينظرون إلا الذين تابوا من بعد ذلك وأصلحوا فإن الله غفور رحيم إن الذين كفروا بعد إيمانهم ثم ازدادوا كفرا لن تقبل توبتهم وأولئك هم الضالون إن الذين كفروا وماتوا وهم كفار فلن يقبل من أحدهم ملء الأرض ذهبا فلن يقبل من أحدهم ملء الأرض ذهبا ولو افتدى به أولئك لهم عذاب أليم وما لهم من ناصرين لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون وما تنفقوا من شيء فإن الله به عليم.
صدق الله العظيم. جزاك الله خيرا. الحمد لله رب العالمين. That brings us to the end of our first night. So inshallah ta'ala, we will catch you here tomorrow evening inshallah for the commentary of the third juz' and the recitation or the beginning of the recitation of the fourth juz' as well inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and your families. Inshallah, Ramadan thus far has been beneficial for all of you, and we look forward to seeing you in physical form soon, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.